The next part of the talk, I'm going to go through a bunch of the numbers involved in my business. Because again, I don't know whether I've done well or poorly compared to what others in my situation would have done, but I'll tell you what did happen to me. And you can compare that to how your business goes. I'm going to throw out a few benchmarks in the middle of that that I think apply to almost everybody in this room. So let's start with just a picture of what's happened over the course of the 31 years. So this is sales, we're going to look at the blue is the new contract value. And then revenues, that's what comes out of the shop in a given year. And I just want to make that distinction because there's a bunch of different ways to keep score of sales. And we find that, you know, the easy one is what was the value of the orders in a given month? And that's what most people consider to be sales. Now, if you do your accounting on an accrual basis, you're looking at what's the value of what leaves the shop in a given month. And that's a crucial distinction because you can actually keep a business alive for a long time if the new contracts are going up, even if you're losing money on the revenues. How do I know that? Because I've done that for about 30 years. So I'm going to separate this, this 30-year run, and we're starting in 1986 on the left, 2017 on the right, and separate it into three phases. So 86 to 92, I'm a single-man shop, and I'm trying to get my business established, and I will literally do anything for a client, because just having a client is so remarkable. Just being able to make a connection with anybody, they ask you to do something, you're like, sure, I can do it, because you don't want that person to walk away. And as you can see, the sales growth is rather low there, but it is going up. In 1993, I got together a brochure and started some print advertising, and this is a no CNC operation, because really just wasn't something that I was capable of handling. You can see that the growth rate about doubles. It's not huge, but it's probably up in the 6-7% a year now. And then when we get the internet and the CNC, you can see the growth rate really goes up. And this is because we're now made a transition from a company with limited reach geographically and limited reach in marketing from Philadelphia to the whole world. And there's a big drop in the middle there, the recession, and some drops near the last 2 years where various things happen I'll go into. But it's a much steeper curve. So that if you're trying to grow a business, having some modern marketing techniques and sales techniques will put you on a different path. Now let's talk about the revenues accrued. In other words, the total value of what went out of the shop. So from 1986 to 2017, we've shipped $34 million worth of product, which is kind of amazing to me. Because when I started it, I was literally a kid with a table saw, and I had no idea any of this was going to happen. This is something that I'm not real happy about. But if you add up all the profit and loss over all those years, we're still $849,000 in the hole. Okay, how did I do that? Where's that money? In 2002, I sold half my business to a partner. And in 2010, after some difficult years, we dissolved the partnership. My partner ate half of that, and I loaned the company money for the rest. So that's where the $849,000 is. And I'm sure that some of you have gotten to moments in your business life where you need to cover payroll, and there wasn't anything to do but write a check or somehow put money in, get cash on your hands, and then it's really hard to pay that back. And I've been fortunate that through circumstances I won't go into, I have had access to money in critical moments. And it's not something I'm particularly proud of because you think, oh, he's such a good businessman. No, I had to call my father on occasion, and I had to take all my savings, everything I'd saved for the college and all the kids, and put it back into the business. And that's pretty much the life of a small businessman. I've heard from hundreds, thousands of people who have gone through the same experience. I wanted to talk about a benchmark that I think is actually quite important here. And this is the revenues versus the number of employees. And We had in 2014, which was our best, most profitable year prior to last year, res per employee, $162,000. And this is a really simple calculation that you can use for any business. And it'll tell you something. It won't tell you everything, but it'll tell you something. And now you guys can all do this calculation in your head. And when I say res per employee, what I'm talking about is per full-time equivalent. And what I've found in talking to hundreds of different manufacturers is that $150,000 to $200,000, if you're making everything that you sell, is a good performance. If you can get to $200,000, you're doing quite well, and that will support good wages and profitability. If you get below $150,000, something has to give. That could be that you're not able to pay your people enough to keep a stable workforce, or it could be that you're not paying yourself enough, or it could be that your business is failing, or it could be that you're going to have to borrow money from somebody. But this is just a number which I've looked at enough to know that this is something to pay attention to. I'm going to go through the different pay rates, what I pay people to keep them around. And keeping in mind that we're located just outside Philadelphia, so this is the northeast corner, and it's not the cheapest place to live if you compare it to Missouri or Kansas or something. When I go out to the marketplace and try to get someone to work for me, I don't offer the minimum wage, like for nothing. I wouldn't even, there's nothing I could get someone, or I want someone to do in my shop that I would pay them that for. If someone's happy to take that, they're not a good worker for me. Same thing with even $12 an hour. And I know now we're getting into the wage range of, say you're in a Midwestern production shop, that's probably where you're at. Now, there are people who will work for this, but they're not the people I need, because we're looking for highly skilled, intelligent people with good work ethic and can get along with each other. That's a long checklist. $15 an hour. This is where we start. We have some workers who are reliable. They're generally immigrants, and they have a driver's license. And so this is, to me, the minimum that someone can survive in Philadelphia. And really, the question is, can they afford a car? If they can afford a car that actually runs, that's good. So you got to pay them enough so they can afford a car that runs. Because if they don't, then they're not going to show up, and it may even not be their fault. So I look at that as like, I need to set up my workplace so that I can give a wage to people that can support the people I want to have work for. Now we find that $18 an hour is competitive for someone who may have come out of a trade school. That would not be the top person in the class. That person has other opportunities in our area. But we have a number of different local trade schools that produce graduates, and that's a wage I would offer to them. $20 to $22 an hour. Someone with good hands, with some work experience, and good references. We start to get into the 25, 28 range for good, stable, competent workers. And that's starting to be enough to really have a middle class life. And that's my goal. $30 to $35 an hour, these are the master guys who are very, very good. We make a lot of different things, and it actually takes years to get, just even to have seen one example of all the things we do. And so this is what I have to pay to keep a person of that caliber. And $40 an hour is my foreman. Whether you can afford to do what I do, that's for you to decide. Now, we have a couple of specialized staff positions that I find harder to hire for. Finishers are really hard to come by on the East Coast, and I don't know whether that's true everywhere, but a good finisher is gold. Engineers. We're now paying $60,000 to $85,000 a year for someone who can understand how to detail out a conference table and understands our production processes. We've actually been promoting people from running the CNC to engineering, because that's most of what needs to happen in that position. The sales guys get half their salary from, I mean, half their money from salary and half from commission. And my two salespeople, the top guys, one made $85,000, one made about $115,000 last year. I have a more lower level salesperson who takes the initial calls and figures out whether we're a good fit. That person's going to make about $60,000 this year. So what are the lessons? As I said, the baseline pay has to be enough for a worker to afford a reliable car if you expect them to get to you. What can I say? I mean, I would rather pay people more and make sure that they're going to be there and make sure they're committed to the company than try to get more profitability by keeping wages down. This is the good stuff, that I have a bunch of valuable workers who have worked for me. My longest running guy is 22 years now. My head salesman, 17 years. Our average is about, I think about 6 years right now, and that's with having hired 4 people in the last year. We've been able to assemble a cadre of workers who are really, you know, they're superior craftsmen, they're good at getting along with each other. The company looks like the kind of thing you would want to join. And that's really, really important. This may be a controversial statement, but I look for things that I know are going to correlate with good performance in when I interview people. And one of them is that they have commitments, that they're interested in a situation that's stable, that produces good wages, because they have a family, or they have debts, or they're not too young, they're not too rootless, or they're not too crusty and old, and they just don't care anymore. And so that's part of the story that I look for when someone comes to work for me. You will need to train people. And this is one of the hardest things about running a small company, which is that it's not always possible to provide a path forward for people, a career path. You know, like what they think of as a career path, you start sweeping the floor and you end up the CEO. That's just not possible in a lot of small shops. That you hire people to do one thing and that thing isn't going to change. And so you have to give them something if you want them to stick around, because otherwise they're going to go someplace else for the next level. And this is just a difficult problem, because you may not have an opportunity to give people more training. And training is really expensive. It's a distraction for the people who know how to do whatever you're trying to train the new person. And it definitely slows down production. And it introduces a level of risk into what you're doing that the person who's being trained may not get it right. I don't know what to say other than you just got to eat that or not do it and accept that there's going to be more turnover in the workforce, because good workers want the bosses to invest in them. And if you do, that's a big trust builder saying, hey, we're the kind of company that you can be with for a long time.